Welcome students. I hope you are all safe in the name of Jesus Christ. Last session we are learned about the classical theory of employment. This session we are going to learn about the Keynes theory of employment and income. Keynes, his name is J.M. Keynes, John Maynard Keynes. He wrote his book, The General Theory of Employment, Interest and Money. This book published in the year of 1936. This book is the turning point in the development of modern economic theory. The theory of Keynes was against the belief of classical economists that the market forces in capitalist economy adjust themselves to attain equilibrium. Keynes not only criticized classical economists but also advocated his own theory of employment. He's not only trying to criticize the classical economists, he advocated his theory of employment. His theory was a general theory as it tried to explain all types of situations. What are the situations? Equilibrium level of employment, but also the concept of full employment as well as the possibility of underemployment. What are the possibilities are there in the underemployment. Keynes' theory of employment was based on the view of the short run. Keynes views only in the short run, not in the long run. According to him, the factors of production such as capital goods, supply of labor, technology and efficiency of labor remain unchanged while determining the level of employment. The level of employment one is determined by the efficiency of the labor. The starting point of the Keynes theory is effective demand. What is effective demand? Let's be discuss. The starting point of Keynes theory of employment and income is the principle of effective demand. This one is the principle of effective demand. Effective demand denotes money actually spent by the people. The money which entrepreneurs receive is paid in the form of, what are the forms? Rent, wages, interest and profit. I think already we are learned in the last year. Therefore, effective demand equals national income. Effective demand is equals to national income. An increase in the aggregate effective demand would increase the level of employment. The aggregate effective demand increases, the level of employment is also increased. A decline in total effective demand would lead to unemployment. When the total effective demand declines, it leads to the unemployment. Therefore, that means total employment of a country can be determined with the help of the total demand of a country. This theory of employment. Who is the author of this theory? Keynes. Keynes' theory of employment. Effective demand signifies the money spent on consumption of goods and services and on investment. The total expenditure is equal to the national income, which is equivalent to the national output. National income is equal to the national output. The national income is otherwise called as effective demand. The relationship between employment and output of an economy depends upon the level of effective demand, which is determined by the aggregate supply and aggregate demand. Effective demand determines the level of employment in the economy. When effective demand increases, employment will increase. When effective demand decreases, the level of employment will decline. The effective demand will be determined by two determinants: consumption and investment expenditure. The consumption function depends upon income of the people and marginal propensity to consume. This theory determines these aspects. If income increases, consumption will also increase, but by less than the increase in income. The rate of interest and marginal efficiency of capital determine the investment level. Rate of interest depends on money supply and liquidity preference. Keynes has given importance to the concept of liquidity preferences. Keynes given importance to the concept of liquidity preference. Liquidity means ready cash. Liquidity preference is based on three motives. There are three motives, namely transaction motive, precautionary motive, and speculative motive. Marginal efficiency of consumption depends on two factors, namely prospective yield of capital assets and the supply price of capital. This flow chart explains about the relationship between employment and output of an economy depends upon the level of effective demand, which is determined by the forces of aggregate supply and aggregate demand. The effective demand determines the level of employment in the economy. When effective demand increases or decreases, the level of employment will decrease or increase. The effective demand will be determined by two determinants, namely consumption and investment. The consumption function depends upon income of the people and marginal propensity to consume. Income of the people, or size of the people, size of income of the people, propensity to consume. According to Keynes, the income increases, consumption will also increase by less than the increase in income. The rate of interest and marginal efficiency of capital determine the investment level. There is money supply and liquidity preference. The liquidity preference, the concept of liquidity preference is based on three motives, namely transaction motive, precautionary motive, and speculative motive. Marginal efficiency of consumption depends on two factors, namely prospective yield of capital asset and supply price of capital. Next, we shift on to the another detailed explanation of ADF, aggregate demand function. In the Keynesian model, output is determined mainly by aggregate demand. The aggregate demand is the amount of money which entrepreneurs expect to get by selling the output produced by the number of laborers. Therefore, it is the expected income or revenue from the sale of output at different levels of employment. Aggregate demand as a four components. Let's see what are they. Consumption demand, investment demand, government expenditure, and net export. Net export means export minus import. The desired demand or planned demand is the amount that households, firms, the government, and the foreign purchases would like to spend on domestic output. In other words, desired demand in the economy is the sum total of desired private consumption expenditure. The desired investment expenditure, desired government spending, and desired net exports, difference between exports and imports. These terms are difference between the changes in the exports and imports. The desired spending is called aggregate spending. Aggregate spending means otherwise called demand, and can be expressed as how we express. This diagram shows ADF explanation. It explains that aggregate demand price increases or decreases with an increase or decrease in the volume of employment. The aggregate demand, when it is increased, the changes in the employment only determine. Aggregate demand curve increases at an increased rate in the beginning and then increases at a decreasing rate. This shows that as income increases owing to increase in employment, when the employment increases, that time only the aggregate demand increases. Expenditure of the economy increases at a decreasing rate. That time the expenditure of the economy also increases. Let's see the aggregate supply function, ASF. Aggregate supply function is an increased function of the level of income. It is the increasing function. Aggregate supply refers to the value of total output of goods and services produced in an economy in a year, in an economy or a year. Otherwise called, the aggregate supply is equal to the value of national product. Aggregate supply is equal to the national product or national income. The aggregate supply refers to the required amount of laborers and materials to produce the necessary output. Employers or laborers purchase various inputs and raw materials to produce goods. Thus, production involves cost. If revenue from the sale of output produced exceeds the cost of the production at a given level of employment, the entrepreneur would be encouraged to employ more labor and other inputs to produce more. The entrepreneur want to encourage the employee to increase the labor and the motive of increase the output also. Aggregate supply price is the total amount of money that all entrepreneurs in an economy expect to receive from the sale of output produced by given number of laborers who are employed and then as a labor. The term price refers to the amount of money received from the sale of output. There are different aggregate prices for different levels of employment. There are different aggregate prices for different levels of employment. Let's see what are the components of aggregate supply. First one, aggregate consumption expenditure. Symbol is C. Aggregate consumption or desired consumption. Second one, aggregate private savings. The symbol is S. Aggregate or desired private savings. Third one, net tax payment. Net tax payment means total tax payment to be received by the government minus transfer payment. Its symbol is T. Fourth one, personal transfer payments to the foreigners. Its symbol is RF. The examples of this, donations to international relief efforts. Aggregate supply function, these are the four components of aggregate supply. This aggregate supply function, equation is helped to understand this. C plus S plus T plus RF is equal to aggregate income generated in the economy. Students, see this curve, the aggregate supply curve. Shows the shape of the two aggregate supply curves. This same diagram, there are two supply curves. The assumption of fixed money wages and variable wages. One of the fixed money wages and the other one is variable wages. Z curve is linear where money wages remain fixed. There is no changes in the money wages when Z and Z1 curve. Z1 curve is non-linear. Z1, Z is a linear curve. Z1 is non-linear curve. The full employment level of NF is reached. It is impossible to increase output by employing more labor. So, aggregate supply curve becomes inelastic. Vertical straight line. Vertical straight line means inelastic means there is no changes. Suppose there is a changes, it is a elastic curve. The slope of the aggregate supply curve depends on the relation between the employment and productivity. The slope of the aggregate supply curve depends on the employment and productivity level. The capital stock is often fixed and hence the law of diminishing marginal returns takes place as more workers are employed. Based upon this relationship, the aggregate supply curve can be expected to slope upwards. In reality, the aggregate supply curve will be like Z1 seen in the figure. Therefore, the aggregate supply depends on the relationship between price and wages. If price high, the wages low, the producers will try to employ labor. If price are low and wages high, investment will be curtailed. Output will fall and there will be a reduction in the productive capacity.